distinguished guests and friends. Good to see you in the evening. And I'm happy that Azim pronounced my name this time very, very accurate. So, first of all, I'd like to thank IDI for inviting a Buddhist monastic to come to this event to let me know about what is Ramadan. I came from Singapore, so we have, in a way, that we're just besides Malaysia. So I have a lot of friends are Muslim, and every year they will have the fasting period of time, but we don't call it as Ramadan. But now I know that this is called Ramadan. So thank you for inviting me. And Azim told me, say that, well, why don't you share about the Buddhist perspective of abstinence and its role to heal many of today's illness. So I would like to share with all of you what I know in Buddhism about this what called fasting or abstinence. So less than 100 years ago, actually a lot of people fear in the life of starvation. But now in the modern world, many people in this world face the death in owing to eat too much. We have too much food that we eat a lot and cause us to have a lot of illness. So what is the perspective of Buddhists to this idea of abstinence? So in Buddhism, abstinence is recognized as one of the methods of practice self-control. We do practice trying to control our eating. So abstinence as a monastic to us is considered an ascetic practice. In a way, it's called the Dudanka. And Dudanka means shake up. The less we eat, the more awake we are. So in a way, Dudanka are a specific list of 13 practices, and four of them is pertaining to food. In our practice is that traditional practice, we eat once a day, and eating at one sitting, reduce the amount we eat, we do arms round means that we go around and do asking for food, eating only the food that we receive in the first seven houses. For monastic, in a traditional way, is that we don't work to earn money. We go around to ask food from the donors. So these practices are adopted by individuals voluntarily. They are not required in the normal course of Buddhist monastic life of practice. The Buddha emphasized moderation, the middle way that avoids extreme to all things. So this is the practice as a monastic. But how about lay people? Lay people, they observe the eight precepts on the full moon days and also observe from taking any solid food after noon. So we take food before 12 a.m. and after that we don't take food anymore. Abstinence in the lay community in Asia is typified by the Chinese word zai, which means the same time as vegetarian as well, and also as fasting. And this point is to remove the meat from one diet twice a month or in the full moon or in the new or full moon day. So these principles hold the removing indulgence from the diet, and in this case means to eat just to satisfy one desire, is already a form of fasting. And also to us, we believe that it brings us merits when we do fasting. So Buddhism, abstinence is the initial state of self-discipline and to acquire self-control. In a way, it's an internal practice rather than just eating. And in every religion, there's a system of fasting, but abstinence and sacrificing a meal once a day, we can contribute our food to those who are starving or who do not have even a proper meal each day. So fasting is not just benefiting ourselves, actually we are helping other people as well. And Buddhist monastic who adopt the abstinence practice also in a way is our practice of meditation. We believe that in meditation, the less food we eat, the more clearer our minds are. So in order to let us to practice the purity in our body, speech and mind, in a way, fasting can help us to do this part. However, as according to the Buddha, fasting will not eliminate our defilement, which means that fasting is just a tool that can help us to concentrate in our practice, but it's our mind that purifies our own mind. So this is about the abstinence in Buddhism. And many people regard all Buddhists as vegetarian, and Buddhism emphasizes vegetarianism. But however, not all Buddhists are vegetarian. So my teacher, which is the Buddha, is not a vegetarian. So vegetarian equals to Buddhism is not a right concept. Not all Buddhists have to be vegetarian. However, it's true that a lot of Buddhists practice vegetarianism. The reason is because it's a practice of compassion to all beings. As according to one of our sutras called the Mahaparinibbana Sutra, the Buddha said that meat eaters, you might not like this term, this sentence. The Buddha says that meat eaters destroy their seat of compassion. You wouldn't like it, right? And then the later generation advocates vegetarianism to practice the spirit of compassion. Because just think in this way, we eat a piece of meat, which means that a being has to sacrifice its life. So in China, Emperor Wu of the Liang Dynasty wrote this essay called The Essay on Giving Up Wine and Meat out of compassion and recommended the entire monastic order to take up vegetarianism. He also encouraged the Buddhist community to take up to be a vegetarian. The reason is just very simple, avoid taking life. Just that. Because Buddhism advocates not killing, but to live a life completely without killing is not an easy task. That's why I said that you won't like the sentences. Meat eater destroy their seeds of compassion. Okay, so this is the Buddhist perspective, and we look into the modern world. Based on the environmental protection perspective, raising animals for food require massive amount of land, food, energy, and water. So as we know that if we have to eat a lot of meat, which means that we have to produce a lot of animals. If we produce a lot of animals, which means that we are creating three things. We are creating a lot of negative things, but three very important negative things that we have to be aware of. One of it is the pollution of the air. The animals produce certain energy from their body in a way that is polluting the air, such as the carbon dioxide, the methane, and the nitro oxides, which created from the cows, the animals. The second thing is that polluting the water. We produce, each factory farms produce billions of pounds of manure that ends up in the drinking water. So in a way is that we are drinking this type of water which has been polluted. And the last thing that is quite serious is the cruelty to animals. The more animals we eat, the more manufacturing, the farmers, they want to produce. And if they want to produce, they will have all kinds of ways, which I will not describe in here, to produce a lot of animals in order to satisfy our needs. So in a way is that because of our desire eating, we caused the increase in the food demand. And this caused the increase in the food supplies. This desire not only destroyed the earth, but also us and our future generation. Buddhism emphasized cause and effect. What we did now will come back to we ourselves. And most important is that it will also come back to our future generation, our children, our grandchildren, our great-great-grandchildren. So Buddhism emphasized about compassion. So not just to compassion to the animals, but compassion to the place we live, the compassion to ourselves, the compassion to our children and our grandchildren. And thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to share the Buddhist perspective in this topic. 你说过。